onto my face.
Here it is.
Someone let Jared know you can hear me while I get my microphone hooked on. I've got it all screwed up. Welcome, welcome. We've got some new folks. We've got some seasoned folks. The snow has goofed earlier today with the internet in our building, but we think it's fine now. We've been told it's good to go. So if anything should happen today, you can assume it's snow related. But don't go anywhere. Okay, so let's just get right into this. We're going to go for about 2 hours today. Then we'll do some sewing in the evening and the morning, and then we'll check back in tomorrow. But today is a lot of mathy kind of stuff, and I will guide you through every step of it. And I'll start with a classic terrible drawing before we really get going. Let me just draw on the back of this. So when you're making a ruffled skirt, here's things that can go wrong or that you can improve on. One thing we're going to do is we're going to make the skirt using gores. So if anybody did the circle skirt class with us and we talked about gores, we're using the gores so that the weight of all of our ruffles hanging on the skirt doesn't make the hem grow where the bias hits the fabric. We're going to use one side of the skirt to hold up the bias on the next side. And then the other thing is when you're thinking about ruffles, let me do a little drawing here. When you're thinking about your girl that's got her ruffled skirt here, right? I often like to put it on a bosque. So we're going to do that for this class. We're going to put a bosque that's 2 inches in the front, and then we're going to make the back of our bosque 3 inches. And what that does is that'll help keep the skirt level to the floor. And we'll revisit all this because I'm sure this doesn't show in the drawing. Then the thing to think about, like design-wise, when you are making a skirt is if you do 4 ruffles or 6 ruffles, for some reason it's not as appealing as 3, 5, or 7. So that's just some old-timey design principle that I don't know why it works, but it worked for, you know, Michelangelo and some of those other guys. So we're going to stick with it for today. And the other thing that, like, so a nice ruffled skirt, I want to show everybody how to like step it up a little bit. A nice ruffled skirt has rows and rows that are all the same length of ruffle, just the whole way down. It's all the same length. But every now and then on YouTube or somewhere, you'll see a video and the ruffled skirt pretty much looks like something you've done before and you can't quite put your finger on why. It's because they look more elegant and sophisticated if you have a slightly shorter row, a slightly longer row, then a slightly longer row. So with what I show you today, you'll be easily able to make one where all the ruffles are the same, but I'm going to show you where the ruffles increase as the skirt goes from the hem to the floor. So they're getting shorter as it moves up to her waist. The other thing that I like to do when I've done these, and the Don Quixote I did for Joffrey is loaded with them, is instead of having a ratio. So, right, so your ruffle is a rectangle. The ruffle's a rectangle that we're going to gather and stick on a base. If you just say, oh, all my ruffles are just whatever my ruffling foot puts out or whatever my ruffling machine puts out, what happens is the top of the skirt ends up too poofy. The top few of them need squished down if you do the same amount of ruffle the whole way. So what I like to do is to actually have the ratio of the ruffle decrease as the length of the ruffle decreases. So we're gonna make a 5-tiered skirt. I've drawn this super long. We're not making it this long. We're gonna go like below knee length. So we're gonna do 5 tiers. 5 tiers. And our ratio is gonna change as we go up the skirt. So 2-to-1 is kind of a wussy ruffle. And 3-to-1 is like a very acceptable theatrical ruffle, like if you're looking in the costume technician handbook. So for our longest ruffle, I'm actually gonna do 3.5 times whatever my circumference is, where the ruffle is sewn on. That's what we're gonna go by. Then we're gonna do 3.25, then 3, then 2.75, then 2.5. So the volume of the ruffles is gonna decrease as we work our way up the skirt. And that's the other thing that, like, when you look at them from the London Royal Ballet or Old City Ballet or Karinska tiered skirts, is they trick you by letting them get shorter as they go up. And they also make a beautiful illusion by adjusting the volume or the amount of ruffle as you work your way up the skirt. Okay? So that's what we're going to do. But we all know that, like a can-can skirt, we can just stick the same exact ruffle on every layer, and that's absolutely correct also. I just want to show this slightly more jazzed up version of the same old thing. Okay, so why don't I, on this side, let's write down the measurements we're going to use. I want a skirt that's 27 inches long when it's done. So the whole skirt from the waist to the hem is gonna be 27 inches. So my skirt's gonna be 27 inches long. I'm gonna do a 26 inch waist. I'm going to do a 32 inch high hip, plus we'll put a smidge of ease in there later on. And then the front of my basque is going to be 2 inches, and the back of my basque is altogether going to be 3 inches. So we're going to do a skirt that's 27 inches long with a 26 inch waist, a 32 high hip, and a basque that is 2 inches in the front and 3 inches in the back. And that extra bit in the back will help the skirt stay level to the floor, or it's also pretty if the skirt angles down some in the back. Like if you look at a Vogue pattern, the lady's skirt is usually longer in the back, and so is like a good pair of pants. So the very first piece of math we're going to do, we're going to start with the skirt and deal with the basque later, is I want my skirt 27 inches long, but 2 inches of it belong to the basque. So I'm going to take 2 from 27. So my gores, we're going to work with 25 inch long gores, okay? So I'm taking my total length minus my basque, which gives us 25 inches. So the first thing we're gonna need to know is that length for our gores is 25 inches. Then we also need to know her high hip, which is 32. Her high hip is 32 inches. And in our skirt gores that we're gonna make here, I just pulled an old one out to refer to. In the gores we're gonna make, if anything, when all these ruffles go on and stuff, sometimes you end up shrinking the top of the gore a little bit with sewing. I am going to add 1 inch to my high hip in the skirt so that if anything, I have to ease a little skirt on instead of wish that my skirt was bigger. So we're gonna do a high hip of 30 with a 25 inch long gore. So this is the gore. So it's gonna be 25 inches from high hip to hem, and it's got to fit we're going to make a 33 inch high hip. Have I lost anybody completely? Because it's going to get real mathy, but I will talk everyone through it. And if it sounds like I'm talking to everyone like we're 5, it's just I'm trying to be clear with the math. Don't take it personally. I'm gonna have some water, some hippie water, because it's in an old jar. They're still there, Jared? Okay. Is anybody totally lost? They're on board? They're on board.
You still need to add to the high hip when that
Well, somebody said, do we need to add to the high hip? Because this is going to get stretched because it's on the bias. There will be some bias on this, but if anything, I like to shoot for the high hip to be intentionally bigger on something like this. Since the top of it's ruffled, it's easier to gather it on. And I find generally, as stuff is getting whacked out and sewn, that we have a tendency to make stuff a little bit smaller. Like even though we're going to put a half inch seam allowance on our 8 gores, if we did them all 5/8, all of a sudden now we've lost the whole inch. So that's why I chose to add a little bit to the high hip. Okay, so let's start making our gores. And let's see who's frantically messaging me. Okay, so I'm gonna just start on the other side of this piece of paper. This is going away forever, remember it. So we're gonna make 8 gores with a 33 inch high hip. And I'm going to start with a square. And the first thing I'm going to do, so instead of like free drafting a gore completely with no help from science and math, we're going to just pretend that this whole thing is a circle, because essentially it's a circle. So when I'm a square, I've got a quarter. And when I fold my square up, now I've got an eighth, right? So I'm going to start with just, so this is an eighth of a circle, and this is an eighth of a circle. And I'm going to be whacking my skirt pattern right out of the center here. And then you can use pi equals r squared or any way you want to get your high hip, but I'm going to use our circumference ruler. So I've got the zero is where I'm going to put my safety pin. And then I'm going to put my pencil on 33, actually, because we're making that size of high hip. So I'm going to put the zero of my ruler on the farthest point out on my angled piece of skirt pattern paper here. And I'm going to put my pencil in 33 and mark that in. So we have no seam allowance yet. Oh, I lost it. We've got no seam allowance. I pulled too hard with my pencil. Then I'm going to tie this piece of string in the same row as we're marking the hem of the skirt. It's so frayed. Will I be able to shove it in there? Yep. So now I need just a plain old tape measure. So I've got one. So I've just moved my string to the row where my high hip is. Get in there. Now, we said that we want this to end up 25 inches long. And so we've got no seam allowance yet. So from my first pencil line, I'm going to just go down on my paper, and I'm going to clearly mark 25 inches. And then I'm going to go over here and mark 25 inches so that when I do my little string magic, if I get off, I can kind of see. So now I just take the string out. You know, like a shaman makes a circle in the woods for his fire pit. I'm going to use the string to make the hem of my gore. Oh, it lined up really good. So now I've got my hem in. And let me do that with a Sharpie a little bit so it shows. So we roughly have a waist in, and we roughly have a hem in. And this is just an eighth. So now my issue, right, pattern-wise, is this is essentially one gore, what we've got from here to here, and I'll be chopping it off so you can see it better later. What we've got from here to here is a gore, but I want to put seam allowance on it, right? I've got nowhere to put seam allowance. Now I'm going to fold this one more time into 16ths. So now we have 16 gores or 16 spokes on a wagon or a snowflake. And that will give me the line so that I can add seam allowance on. Haha, see, so now I have, by dividing that in 16, I'm going to take my gore right out of the center. So I'm wasting paper, but I'm saving time. So since this is folded in half, right where my hand is, that's a 16th of our pattern. But when we cut this apart and open it, now we have an eighth, which is what we're going for. So now I have somewhere I can put the seam allowance on. So we're doing 1/2 inches at the sides of the gores, and we're going to do 1/2 inch at the waist. And I'm only going to do 1/4 inch at the hem because we're going to finish this off with horsehair braid. Or I'm going to show you another way I like to finish it off, where I just take a strip of bias of the fashion fabric and pull it a little bit while I sew it on the hem so that it rolls up and makes a nice finish. So let's cut this much out. And this skirt's going to have a petticoat too. So actually, if I have enough, let's see if I have enough paper to get my petticoat at the same time. I do. See what I did there? Did I lose anybody yet? I want a copy of my overskirt base to make my petticoat with. So I just folded it. So now I'm going to put a pin in this so it doesn't slide around. So now when I cut this out, I have the beginning of my petticoat pattern too. Because this one that all the ruffles get sewn on is going to get so marked up, we're going to use a separate one to mark the petticoat. And the skirt gores are going to go straight to bias. So even though I've picked out an organza with a stripe on it, you're not really going to see the skirt base. And what's to me is more important is that the skirt isn't full of droopy weird spots. So now actually what I'm going to do is find the center of my gore, because when this is getting sewn, we want to make sure that we're lining up the top, bottom, and middle very, very evenly. So I'm going to mark that with a Sharpie, and I'm going to take, this is from the vet store, it's like pattern notcher, but it's used to mark baby pigs' ears if they've had their vaccines, and it's a lot cheaper. So I'm going to put a great big old notch right there. So now in my, so that's going to be our petticoat. So now in our overskirt, we have a point at which we know every seam has got to line up as we work our way down the thing. Okay? Okay, we're good. Everybody's satisfied. We're moving on to starting to mark the ruffles. So the thing that you've got to think about with something like this is that there's, so I've got some piles of ruffles that I've started. If we have 7 inches of the ruffle that we want to show, if we want 7 inches of a ruffle to show, you have to decide, Humphrey, Nebraska, that's a spam call. You have to decide how much is hidden. Some people call it the, like, the reveal or the return, how much is hiding underneath the part above it. So for today, we're going to do 1.5 inches. So for every amount of ruffle that shows, I'm sticking 1.5 inches up underneath the ruffle above it. And I'm also going to be edging the ruffles with some creamy lace because it's a nice way to finish off the edge and make it a little bit richer. So the creamy lace is going to lengthen each of my ruffles to helping hide where the ruffle below it is tucked in, okay? So we're going to have a ruffle that's that long, and then one that's a little bit shorter, one that's a little bit shorter as we work our way up towards the waist. So the things that are going to get marked on this pattern, and it is handy to mark it in different colors, which don't totally show on the camera, but I'm going to start with it folded in half because the marks that I put over here, I want to put in the middle and on the other side. So I'm going to work with it folded in half. In fact, I could work with it folded in fourths just to make marking it even easier. And a notcher or a tracing wheel, a notcher or a tracing wheel will help in all of this. Okay, so now the first set of lines that we're going to put on here is the part of the ruffle that actually shows. So the part of the ruffle that shows is separate from where the ruffle is sewn on. So where I'm going to make my lines working the way up for the visible part of the ruffle, then we've got to go back and mark where the ruffle is actually attached. Because like our short little ruffle at the top that's getting sewn into the bosque doesn't need the extra to hide underneath. It just needs the seam allowance of the bosque because there's no ruffle hanging over the top of it. And with a 25-inch skirt, there's a reason why I made this happen, is I can go 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, and I get my five ruffles, and it adds up to 25. So if you've got some other number, you just have to kind of trial and error if you're doing a graded skirt. So you could say you're going 8, 7.5, 7, 6.5, 6, and see if you're happy with that, or you just adjust in between. You could also figure out how much of bottom ruffle do I want to show, how much of top ruffle do I want to show, and then divide up to figure out how much longer each consecutive ruffle is. Does that make sense? That should make sense. I just start with something and work my way to the top and see if I'm happy with it. So then, like, if you were doing this same skirt and you were making a set for girls that are 2 inches longer, you just kind of split the difference so that their longest ruffle is a hair longer, their next one's a hair longer, to absorb that 2 inches. So the first thing I'm going to do is we're going to mark the visible part of the ruffle. So my first one is 7 inches. And having this folded up an extra time helps a lot when we get to marking this. So I'm going to just write here that this is 7 inches visible. Then my next one is going to be 6, and this is a 6-inch ruler. Aha. My next ruffle is 6 inches. My next ruffle is 5 inches. The one after that is 4. And with my fat Sharpie, I'm a little off. I've ended up with 2 3/4 at the top, but that's close enough to 3 for me. So now, right, we've marked the part of the ruffle that shows. So we've got a 7-inch, a 6-inch, a 5-inch, a 4-inch, and a 3-inch, even though I ended up a little bit off from 3. Nobody will know. So that's the first thing I'm going to mark, is how much visible ruffle I've got. Then we're going to go in and mark where the ruffle is actually sewn. And I have some colored pencils that I just grabbed. Like, they'll even show up. Do you see like a maroon colored pencil? It's like Sewing with Helen Keller. Oh, no. Oh, here they are. So now I'm going to go 1.5 inches above each of these to mark where my actual ruffle is stitched. So 7 inches shows, but my 7-inch ruffle is hiding under my 6. And I'm even going to write 7 inches there. So I know that's where my 7-inch shows. Then my 6 is hiding up under my 5, also 1.5 inches. That's where my 6-inch ruffle is sewn. My 5-inch ruffle is hiding up underneath 4. That's where my 5-inch one is sewn. My 4 is hiding right underneath 3. And 3 doesn't get the extra 1.5 inches. It just gets 1/2 inch because the top of my seam allowance at 3 is only 1/2 inch. So the black line is the visible ruffle. the red line is where it actually is sewn on. So now we can figure out what is the actual length we're cutting of the ruffle. So if I've got my 7-inch ruffle and it's stuck up there an inch and a half, so then you have to decide how you're finishing your ruffles. We're gonna just serge the edge for this one and stick lace on it. So we're not shortening the ruffle, the lace is making it longer. If you wanted to hem the ruffle, you have to add your hem into this scenario right now. So if you were gonna hem all the ruffles a half of an inch, you need your 7-inch that shows, you need your inch and a half to tuck it under, plus your 1/2-inch seam allowance. And then what I like to do is add an extra 1/8. So that whether you're hemming it or serging it, that extra 1/8 gives you just a little bit of wiggle room. And when we serge it, it's gonna get shrunk a tiny little bit anyway. So then the other thing is this attachment point, that's where the top edge of the fabric is gonna go. No matter how I gather it, I'm not gonna put my gathering stitch there, I'm putting the top edge of the fabric. So you can change that. You just have to know what you decided to do for your scenario. So I've got 7-inch that shows, plus an inch and a half, that gives me 8.5. I'm gonna cut this one at 8 5/8 because I like to have just a smidge extra fabric. So my 7-inch, I'm gonna cut at 8 5/8. My 6-inch, I'm gonna cut at 7 5/8. My 5-inch, I'm going to cut at 6 5/8. My 4-inch, I'm going to cut at 5 5/8. Now, the 3-inch one doesn't need the extra inch and a half to tuck up in there. It just needs a 1/2 inch to go into the bosque. So my 3-inch one, I'm gonna cut it 3 inches plus the 1/2 inch that goes away plus an 1/8 just because. So I'm gonna cut this one at 3 5/8. And marking all of this out on your pattern is very, very helpful as you're figuring it out. Like the pattern is your guide for the whole thing. So if you've got, the more info you've got sorted out before you start, the better you are. Okay, we're gonna move on to figuring out how long all of these ruffles are gonna be cut. And actually, let's mark our placement lines right now. So I'm gonna fold this even one more time, because I'm gonna let the pattern notcher do most of the work here for me. So the red lines are my placement lines. So the red is where I'm actually marking on my skirt base. So I'm gonna use my pig notcher. It goes through leather, so it'll go through paper. And I'm marked all, so it's like making a snowflake. So by folding that up, now I've got my marks the whole way across the skirt. I have my connection points all marked. I could also mark the very edges if I want, but I'm not going to on this one because I don't want to confuse it with my notch for halfway. So I'm good enough at eyeballing and connecting the lines while I sew that I've got enough marks. If you need more marks, put more marks on it, okay? Okay, so now we're gonna figure out ratios. So I'm going to, for fun, just do this on, would you hand me a spool of tape? Or are they all hidden? There's one. I'm gonna do them on little pieces of notepaper and tape them right to my pattern so that we can kind of work through the math together, and then I can hold it up and show you. Thank you. Okay, so my 7-inch one, let me just tape these on. 1 7-inch, 6-inch, 5-inch, 4-inch, 3-inch. We're gonna, remember earlier in our drawing, I said we're gonna make more ruffle at the bottom and less ruffle, like the ratio of the ruffle as we work up towards the top. So I'm going to start in the middle of mine, just writing what that ratio down was. This one's going to be 3.5. This one's going to be 3.25. This one's going to be 3. This one's going to be 2.75. And this one's going to be 2.5. That's the ratio that we're doing. Again, you can ruffle them all the same, which is totally fine. I just want to step it up because this is a class. Then the next thing that we need to figure out is actually where the ruffle is sewn on. We need to figure out the circumference of that point of the whole skirt. So right now our pattern is an eighth. We're dealing with an eighth of a skirt pattern. I'm going to fold it in half for just a minute. So we're back to dealing with a 16th. And here's why I did that. Let me get a calculator. Would you grab me that calculator way over there too? Unless there's one in the drawer. Is there one in that left drawer? No. Okay, grab it. There's one right on your table. So on my little notepads, we're gonna figure out the ratio of all this stuff. And then you decide what you want to do. You can figure out the ratio by where the skirt is sewn on, or you can figure out the ratio by where the ruffle hangs. Or if you want to get ultra fancy, you can figure out the point in between. But the idea is that, like, they're all correct. You just decide what you're doing for your skirt. So what I'm going to do is I'm measuring. So I've got a 16th of this of the whole skirt. We're divided in half now. I'm measuring the connection point of 1/16 of my lowest row, which is 8 inches. So I'm going to take 8 inches times 2, 16 inches. So one gore is 16 inches across at this point, at my where my 7 is sewn. I'm going to take that times 2, which is 32. So, oh no, I'm going to take that times 8. Let me go back. I always get confused describing this stuff, but I'm here. I'm going to get it right. So 7, where my 7 is sewn on, my gore folded in half is 8 inches, so my whole gore is 16 inches. One gore at this point is 16 inches. We have 8 gores for this skirt, so I'm going to take 16 times 8, 128 inches. And the first thing I'm going to write down is 128. And we're taking this one times 3.5. So the actual circumference at that point for row 7 is 128 inches times 3.5. So I'm going to take 128 times 3.5, and that gives me 448 inches. So my lowest ruffle, we figured out is 8 5/8 inches tall. So it's going to be 8 5/8 by 448 inches. How great is that? So that's what this little piece of paper is for. And I'm going to stick it on there really good. You could also transfer that right onto the pattern. So let's do the next one. My next one up, I'm going to measure where it's sewn to and double it because my pattern is folded in half. 6 times 2 is 12. So I'm going to take 12 times 8 is 96. I don't trust myself. That's right. Then I'm going to take 96 times 3.25. So this is going to be 312 inches. By 7 5/8. Right? This way doesn't work really well if you're planning to just ruffle. But like I said, ruffling is totally fine to just ruffle it all. We're doing gathered style so we can balance things out and keep it nice and even. Next one, I'm going to measure where it's sewn. 4 inches times 2 is 8. So 8 times 8, I should know this, but I'm live, is 64. So I'm going to take 64 times 3, 192 inches. So this one's 192 inches by 6 5/8. I'm going to do the next one. This one is 2.5 times 2 is 5. 5 times 8 is 40. And we're doing it times 2 3/4. 110 inches. By 5 5/8. Then our number shortest, so we can call the shortest one 1. It doesn't matter which one. You can go 1 2 3 4 5 or 1 2 3 4 5. Why don't we'll do our shortest at the top. 1 2 3 4 5. That one is sewn right into the bosque, and it's like 1 3/4. It's like 2 inches. So 2 times 2 is 4. 4 times 8 is 32. So I'm going to take 32 times 2.5, and that gives me 80. My top one is 80 inches by only 3 5/8. Any questions about what we just did? So I've got the sewing lines are marked on my skirt, and we have figured out the height and length of each ruffle.
Why did you switch to 3 instead of 3.5? This is an ordered question.
Someone said, why did I switch to 3 instead of 3.5? I'm going by quarters. So the ratio. So 2.5 plus 1/4 is 2.75. 2.75 plus 1/4 is 3. 3 plus 1/4 is 3.25. And 3.25 plus 1/4 is 3.5. I'm not sure if that was the answer to your question, but I think that was. I've kept my ratio evenly adjusted. You could adjust it by a whole number if you want a crazy skirt. You could go 5 times, 4 times, 3 times, 2 times. You could go 3.5, 3, 2.5, 2. But see how I've adjusted it so that I can work my way up. If you've got 7 rows, you might go 3 3/4. You know, you just have to decide the amount. Like, what really throws people is that when I teach, I tell you there's no right way to do it, and that here's the idea behind it, and then you need to take it and do what you need to do, right? That wasn't too tangent-y, was it? And this is what I'm doing for today. So now let's open our skirt pattern back up, and let's just write on each of these spots what's on our little note too, so we don't lose it. So this one is going to be 8 5/8. By 448. The next one is 312 by 7 5/8. Then we've got 192. Look, I switched which way I'm putting the numbers. That's all right. You guys are smart. Then I've got 110 by 5 5/8. Now I've got 80 by 3 5/8. Okay, cool, rock and roll. Now, what we're gonna cut out first, actually we're gonna get our petticoat pattern going. We're gonna cut out the skirt bases, and then we're gonna cut out ruffles. And I pre-cut my ruffles, but I'm gonna show you kind of how I deal with figuring all of that out. And we're gonna be sewing these straight to bias. So the same side of the skirt the whole way is going to be on the straight of grain. So even though I've got a striped organza, the base of my skirt really isn't going to show, we're going to have an interesting angle going on with every skirt gore, but it's going to keep the skirt from drooping. And as an audience member and somebody who sews, I care more about the skirt not being a droopy mess. I have read in some of the groups that some folks just say, oh, you cut a circle out of organza and sew organza on it. Organza isn't very heavy. It won't droop. And then, you know, as soon as the picture of this project comes out, what I see is a droopy mess. I don't see the pretty trim and the pretty lace first. I see the state of the skirt. So I'm marking on one side my straight grain. I also know that there's a school of folks who cut like a layer of organza with the grain down the middle, and then they cut like two or three layers of diamond net and quilt the whole thing together. That works great too. But if you just cut your gores so they go straight to bias, you don't have to deal with all of that other stuff. Unless that layer of netting is helping give you volume that you want or do something else to promote your design, then flat it with netting. But I don't. Because I don't. Okay, so now we need to cut out eight of these. And cut out eight of those. Now let's do our petticoat really quick. So the petticoat in this one is going to be, I've got this pink that you guys have all seen. Then I've got this re-embroidered organza. Let me go grab my petticoat. I'm back. So our petticoat is going to be out of this white stuff that's got a little bit of embroidery on it. And our petticoat is also going to be cut straight to bias. So even though the petticoat is cut straight to bias, it's got diamonds on it, there'll be a weird angle under the petticoat, but the ruffle that hangs out it is going to be all straight. So again, I'm going for the fact that the skirt isn't a droopy catastrophe. I'm choosing that over the fact that naturally we all want to make these run vertical. Does that make sense? If you wanted to make these run vertical, I will give you 100% approval if you cut 16 gores out. If you're into matching diamonds and stuff like that, cut 16 small gores out so that you have less angle in your bias. You could cut 16 out centered. But we're going to cut eight out with the straight on one side is what we're going to do for today. So this pretty stuff will be our petticoat. Or like just get something that has no pattern on it at all and then it won't bother you. The petticoat, I'm going to kind of fall in the rule. I'm going to say we're doing the petticoat ruffle. So the petticoat will have a base. It's just the same shape as our overskirt base. And we're going to put a ruffle hanging on the bottom of it. And we're going to put this ruffle one third of the way up. You could put a short ruffle at the bottom. You could put a ruffle that's two thirds. I just always think it's more interesting to have it not be in the center, like not be exactly halfway. But that's just my flavor for this kind of stuff. So I'm going to divide this into thirds. So I'm not counting my seam allowances. I've got my thirds there. And we are going to put a ruffle on the bottom third of this sucker. And you have options here too. You can either quack this gore off and let the ruffle hang right on the end, or you can cut the gore the whole length and mount the ruffle to it. I don't see a huge advantage or disadvantage either way, but I'm going to do it where I've got my whole gore and then the ruffle sewn on it. So the ruffle will face her leg, and then the wrong side of the petticoat gore will face the wrong side of the fashion gore so that all your seams are sandwiched in between the two and you never see the seams. And the other thing with having the seams face each other is we can swing tack them or crochet loop them together so that you you don't have that problem of the overskirt lifting up and then the petticoat hanging down and getting stuck between her legs. Boy, my phone is just blowing up today with all these people I don't know. I always panic that it's somebody in the class that's like, I don't know how to log in. Oh, no, it's a telemarketer scam. Okay, so I've marked a third for my petticoat. And then I'm going to do just like we did with the overskirt. And I'm going to just fold this up like a snowflake. And I am going to mark the attachment line for my petticoat here. Wham, bam, like that. Then we've got to decide what we're doing with the petticoat ruffle. Are we hemming it or are we just serging it? Or are we going to stick a piece of lace on it? And I feel like sticking a piece of lace on it is what I'm going to do. So it's going to get sewn right here. I have a 1/4 inch seam allowance at the bottom. So I'm not going to concern myself with that yet. And I end up with, how is a third of 25 close to 8? Yeah, because 8 times 3 is 24. Yeah. So I'm just a little bit under 8, but I've been drawing with a Sharpie. It's like, oh, actually, it should be a little bit over 8. It should be more like 8 1/3. So I'm going to say that the top of my pattern notch is where I'm actually going to sew. So then I'm going to make this just an 1/8 longer like we've done on the other layers to give us a little bit of something to serge off. So I'm going to make this 8 3/8 plus another 8, so 8 1/2. So 8 1/2 is the magic length of my petticoat ruffle. Then we're going to do the same thing. And I'm going to make this just a happy 3 times as full because it's underneath and it doesn't need to be super ruffly. Now, right, so this is an architectural thing too. So if you want your skirt to be huger, more of a triangle, have more va-va-voom to it, you might make this ruffle 4 times as much, or you might just ruffle something on your ruffle and say that's the bottom of my petticoat ruffle because it's hanging in just one spot. But I'm going to say we're going to make this one 3 times as much. So I've got 8 1/2. This is folded in half. So that becomes 17. I'm going to take 17 times 8 gores, 136 times, I'm going to make it 3 times as full, 408. So this ruffle is going to be 8 1/2 inches by 408 inches. Okay, let's cut some of this out. Let me get my pink up here. So we're cutting it straight to bias, and one of the reasons why I selected this stuff is I'm hoping we can sell it to somebody for a Clara dress, but it's organza with a satin stripe woven into it. And what's great is the satin stripe is the same on both faces of the fabric. So it has no right or wrong side. So cutting it out goes pretty, pretty slick. So let me get my pattern. And like I said, we're making the same side of it. I've got so many hairs hanging off of this. It's like a Halloween spider web. We're making the same side of this on the grain line. So I'm never going to flip my pattern over. It's going to jack with my grain being on the same side. This, if anybody is new to this, that there's a grain holding up a grain, it goes back to old-timey Victorian stuff. If you think of the walking skirt that Nicole Kidman wears at the end of Moulin Rouge, where she's gray and she's coming back to tell Christian she's done. That's cut straight to bias. That's a pretty good reference. I'm surprised I pulled that out and got their names right. Is his name Christian? I think it's Christian. So we're going to cut this straight on the same side. So I'm not going to flip my pattern over, but what I can do is I can rotate my pattern. So I can wang it around to save fabric like that, but I am not going to flip it over. So if you were cutting these out separate, and you can also decide, like, I have a stripe. I don't really care where the stripe lands, but if you wanted, you could cut like between the stripes, or say I'm putting an edge of a stripe. I am going to just use some weights that I've got around here. I'm going to cut two out single first, and then I'll cut multiples, because I like to cut multiples whenever I can. Now I've got this cup. I can't turn it around, though, because it says something naughty. So let me cut out two single ones. So the bias edge is holding up the other edges. Now, if you've taken a bodice class with me, you know that like we add the seam allowance on later. For stuff like this, put the seam allowance on before you start. 100%, absolutely. I went a little crooked. But now that I'm here, I am going to take and mark all my stitching lines. If you have a vet or farm supply store near you, look for a pig ear notcher. It's great. It's cheaper than a pattern notcher, and it goes through a ton of stuff. So now I'm marking this point that I was real nutso about earlier, like that we have to match the sides. So I've marked that point. Now you can nestle it. So if I flip it this way, now I can not have a bunch of waste, right? I can almost line this one up right where I cut the last one out. So this will give us 2 of 8. Yeah, I wish I could get this striped stuff in more colors. Textile Warehouse has it. If you've ever enjoyed a trip to that place, it does come with little specks of crud on it, but you know, you get such a good deal. Let's see how horribly close I cannot get to that. Hey, not bad. I'm impressed. Okay. So we're going to remark that whole thing. Almost lost my note. And when we get to sewing this, we're going to put the bias side towards the feed dogs, and we're going to put a few pins in it. Not so many pins that you spend your whole time pinning. Improve your sewing skills if you need a billion pins on this. We're going to be sewing them straight bias. I was going somewhere else with that, but I got confused. Okay, so now we have 2 out of 8 gores. But you can start, oh, I didn't mark my side notches. I want my side notches. So now I'll kind of demonstrate. Also, it's fun. Look through Victorian books and see all the crazy things that people have done when they, I worked with one woman who would tell me to embrace the stripe. Instead of trying to make stripes always centered or symmetrical, you can come up with some really neat things by just saying, hey, we're doing this with the stripe. Here's what happens. So now let's look. So now when this is going to get sewn, my straight edge, I can't make it grow at all. So I've got just 2 out of our 8 gores here. But my bias edge, look at that. I can make that 3. I just barely pulled on it. I can make that 3, almost 4 inches longer because it's on the bias. So what happens when you cut your skirt gore down the center for something like this, you get Batman wings the whole way around, because even though if you cut the grain down the center, you still have some bias at each seam, and the weight of the ruffles is going to pull it down like to a, like a little bird, like a frump, 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 frump the whole way. So we're letting the straight piece be the responsible, the designated driver here, and I'm going to pin my straight on top of my bias. So I've matched my notch. I've matched my hem. And then I'm going to put just one pin in between those spots because I'm not going to spend the whole time pinning. And by putting the bias one underneath, the sewing machine is going to help me match it all up. So the whole way around our skirt, we're going to go straight to bias. And even though there's something unique going on with the stripes, once this is covered with a billion vertical pink ruffles, no one will see this. What they won't see is a weird hem, okay? So now let's cut out multiples. So we've got 2 out of 8. Ain't that great? Get it? I rhymed. Now I'm going to fold this up so that I can, I'll have to undo it to mark them, but I can at least cut less times. So I'm going to fold this and see if I can get 2 gores at the same time. You could fold it up 4 times even, which is what I probably would do, but I'd have to dangle it over the floor to line it all up. Yeah, that's pretty good. So now, right, I'm able to fold this up because my stuff is the same on both sides. If your stuff wasn't the same on both sides, you would have to like cut sections and stack them so that the right side was all facing the heavens, okay? So we've got 2 cut. This will make 3, 4, and 5, and 6, and then we'll only have 2 more. Does anybody have questions about anything so far because I'm cutting? Check this out too, right? Because I'm going to hook the next one right here. I don't want to start out in my good goods with the rotary cutter. I don't want to put a notch or a little chink out of the fabric there because I'm going to nestle things. I've been to this race before. Okay. That's not quite the wording. I'm not new to this race. No, I've raced a horse. This isn't my first rodeo. That's what I was going for. So again, mark stuff. You don't need to stitch these lines in unless you feel like you need to. Now, since I've got the one side marked, what I'm going to do is just put a couple pins underneath there in my fabric and hope that I can see the mark if I just flip this over. So the petticoat, I'm going to cut out the same, but I won't bore you guys with cutting out the petticoat. We will cut that out in the night. I can see them. I can see them. I can almost see them. Then when we put this together, I am going to just straight stitch my seams, and then I'm going to serge the 2 of them together. We'll deal with the opening in the back tomorrow. You could also French seam all of this together. So that is totally up to you. And I pull this out every now and then, but we do have some new books. This is a good book to get. There's an edition from the 1970s that's got like a vomit orange cover with yellow. They haven't changed anything other than the cover. So this Vogue sewing book is loaded with stuff about putting horsehair in the hem, when you sew bias, where to put it, how to understitch, how to do that thing I just said, how to French seam, how to flat felt seam. So the stuff like this, right? You can never be done with your education. If you don't have this book, get it and look at it while you watch great stuff on Netflix. And I want everybody to watch The Christmas Chronicles with Russell. No, what's his name? Who's the guy in Christmas Chronicle? Kurt Russell. It's so good. Okay, back to work. So now, see, that's why I didn't just randomly slice my rotary cutter into there, because I can use that piece here to cut my next one. That'll give us six, and we've only got two more. And then I'm going to show you how I start cutting out all of these ruffles. Out of the whole group, let me know, is there a person, you're anonymous too, sir, and I won't blurt out your name. Is there somebody that needs me to draft a bosque, or has everybody drafted a bosque with me and understands that? Because I'm happy to do it. Jared, don't blurt out the name. Don't even tell me the name, and then I can't, you know, it's between you and Jared. Or can I make a bosque tomorrow morning and we just use it? Yes, we've got a different question. Somebody said, could you make a gourd skirt out of netting? You absolutely can. There's a ballet, has the worst title in the world. It's called Pretty Ballet. It's by Yuri Posikov. And those are gourd tutus made out, you don't have, those are gourd tutus made out of tulle, the good tulle, not the crawly tulle. But I for sure would not make a ruffled base out of netting and put ruffles on it, because as soon as she runs by a lighting instrument, where the ruffle is sewn onto the net is going to just rip off like the perforation on a cat food bag. Oh, good. We are going to do the bosque then. Jared said there were several requests. So you are not alone, whomever you are. Okay. I've got six. I'm going to do two more. And actually, you know what? Time-wise, we're doing pretty good. I'm putting a couple more lines here so I can see it really good on the underside. I'm going to cut my two more pink just because I've got the pink out on the table. Then we're going to start cutting ruffles.
Another question.
Yeah, another question.
If you're doing hooks and bars in the back and adding extra for dancers of different sizes to share, would you add the extra inch to the back board as well?
Oh, yeah. Somebody said if we're making the bosque adjustable with other sets of hooks and bars, would we add more underlap in the skirt? You absolutely can. You could add a couple inches more to the hip and make the back of the skirt travel into your underlap. You can also make a placket so that even though the ruffles might not touch, we'll make a placket in this one. Even though your ruffles might not touch the placket, we'll fill in your back. Very good question. It's always easier to make something smaller, that's for sure. Let me get two more of these just while I've got the fabric. Well, we're going to have the fabric for ruffles too. So my eight white ones, I'm not going to cut out because you guys don't need it. Just watch me cut the same stuff over and over. So when we get to cutting the ruffles out for this, right, here's kind of my approach. If we were doing all the same ruffles, which is absolutely correct also, the same ratio, I would just cut tons of strips out and start ruffling them and figuring out what I'm doing with my edge, whether I'm putting lace or a rolled edge or a serged edge or a hemmed edge. Then you just cut out a bunch, start sewing them on and see if you need more. With this, with there being more at the bottom and less at the top, I kind of take my longest length. So when we get to it, our 448, I'm going to take my longest length and divide it by either two or three and see if it comes close to some other length. Then, and I do that so that we're not wasting tons and tons of fabric. Because if I was going to unroll 448 inches, then I only need 312 and then 192. We're going to end up with all this wasted scrap. So I've got a way where I waste a little bit, but don't waste a ton. And I'm going to show you that also. And with this, we're lucky that I want vertical stripes going down my skirt because I'm going to railroad cut my ruffles. Now, if the stripe went the other way on the fabric and you wanted vertical stripes, you're going to be cutting across the cross and then grafting it together, which is also correct. Like the same thing won't happen twice. No, somebody asked if there's an easy way to figure out the yardage. Do you know what I do? I buy the entire roll, and then I'm good. That's not a nice answer, but that's my answer. I just don't know. It's so funny, too. Some of the stuff that we've made for years, I can honestly not tell you how much fabric it takes just because I just get way more than we need. So, but I'll think about it tonight. We might be able to figure out how much we use for this. So far, I can tell you that I have used, let's figure out how much is in the base. We can figure this out. I can actually totally figure this out. In the base, every 24 inches, every 48 inches makes 1, 2, 3, 4 gores. 48 inches makes 4 gores. So you need that times 2. So you need 96 inches to make 1 skirt base, whether it's a petticoat or not. So let's do that. This stuff is not quite 60 inches wide. This is like 55 inches wide. So you need 2.6, so round that up. So you need 3 yards to make the gores for the overskirt, and you need 3 yards to make the gores for the underskirt. Then our ruffles, we'll do it here together, but my first ruffle is 448 inches. But my first ruffle, I divided into 3 pieces, and I'll talk you through that here in a second. I divided that by 3, so that's 150. And then the last chunk I needed to get the rest of my ruffles was only 80 inches. So that's 230. So you need approximately 6.5 yards to make the ruffles. So it's quite a bit, it's a lot of fabric. Now, even though, and I'll show you this here in a second, even though I said you need 6.5 yards to make your ruffles, you're going to end up with about 80 inches that you don't use the whole thing up. So you're ending up kind of with about 2 extra yards, but that's making it faster and easier to cut out the whole thing. So if you didn't want to end up with these 2 extra yards, you could say that instead of having your longest, widest, lowest ruffle with 3 seams in it, you could say that ruffle is going to have 4 seams in it, and then you'll end up wasting less fabric. But now it sounds like that sounded super confusing. I'm going to go through how I cut these ruffles out now, the like roundabout circular Travis thinking that like will make sense on some other project in a month, but I guarantee it works. So let's do that. But I think I'm going to use a piece of paper. Oh, I didn't mark these. I'm going to use a piece of paper and just talk you through it. So we're going to use our imaginations, and we're going to imagine that my piece of paper is fabric and that it's actually longer than I tell you it is. Oh, yeah, we'll make the boss pattern today. So we'll do some of this sewing in the night and in the morning, and then we'll do the finishing upping tomorrow. I'm running out of pencils. So, right, my mark doesn't show through the satin part of the stripe, so I'm just moving it to the organza part of the stripe. If you look real close at this fabric, it's got little fly poops all over it, too. I don't know what it's from, but it's why it's such a good deal. And I also need to mark my notch here so that I can line it up top to bottom. Even on things that should be a straight line, like if you've got straighter grain to straighter grain, it's nice to have an idea where the middle is. Because if you just like pin on one end and go the other way, it's not going to line up because we're all human. And as accurate as we try to be, there will always, 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 always be trouble.
Another question. What would happen if you made an overskirt with no ruffles and only put the ruffles on the underskirt petticoat? Do you need to make the overskirt cooler?
So Somebody said, well, that's like a can-can dress. Somebody said, what if you have an overskirt that's flat, seamed together, and you put all the underskirt with the, put all the ruffles on the underskirt? Do you need to make the overskirt fuller? Not really. The only time you would need to make the overskirt fuller is if you have so many ruffles that the underskirt has lifted the overskirt beyond the height of her waist. Does that make sense? So there you would have to have so many ruffles against her leg in a can-can skirt that, where you would need to make this larger, the overskirt. Did that answer it? Because the gravity will always keep the underskirt smaller than the overskirt can exist at its fullest. I think that makes sense. I don't know. Some of the new people are like, oh my God, this guy's the worst. Okay, now, what did I say I was going to do? We're going to cut out ruffles in this really roundabout way. Actually, I can use this leftover, this chunk, right, that I cut my gores from. I have this weird massacred edge. We're going to use that. Everybody take 10 deep breaths. We're going to use that to kind of go through this whack-a-chewy plan of how we cut this out. So let's actually look at the ruffles. So I cut these ruffles out yesterday. I've got my 8 5/8, my 7 5/8, my 6 5/8, my 5 5/8, and my other one. And let's lay them down on here to do in order. And let's just kind of preview my little notes, and then you'll be like, oh yeah, I get it. My first note here says, my note here says 7 inches shows. That's my lowest ruffle. To get my ratio exactly like I wanted it, I'm taking away 36 inches from whatever this length is. My next one, 6 inch shows, my note says good as is, ready to go. My next note up originally said needs 60 inches. So I had to cut another 60 inch chunk somewhere to add to this ruffle. My next one says minus 48, and then my top one says good as it is. So what I've done is I've come up with some length to measure off first that gets me kind of close, because what I don't want to do is cut out something that's so freaking long that I'm wasting 100 inches of length, or cut out something that's so short that I have to put billions of vertical seams in. So my aim is to have a couple seams in the ruffles, but not tons of seams. And it's much easier for me to have something where I need to take away 36 inches or take away 48 inches than it is to spend so much time trying to cut it out. I think that makes sense. Does that make sense? It kind of makes sense. But let me show you what I did. So let's go back to my original info, and I'm gonna start with the longest, the bottom one. Now again, I have a sense that this has thrown some people that I'm making the bottom fuller and the top not as full, and that you can just ruffle it and put it down. Absolutely, that is also correct. But by making the bottom fuller and the top less, I kind of have to monkey with the math a little bit. So my longest bottom one is 448 inches. And even though you're like, well, a yard, that's not much difference. To keep my ratio, I want to actually stick to my ratio, because our brains are somehow better at spotting things that, like, don't make a cone, or don't, you know, it's like we can pick out the thing that bothers us, because we're like so developed, even though I think compared to the universe, we're probably not that developed. That's my total tangent there. So I'm going to take my bottom one is 448 inches, the whole thing, end to end, that gets sewn onto this bottom part of my whole skirt, 448. First, just out of the thin air, I'm going to divide that by 2. That's 224 inches. I'm going to see how close any of my other ruffles are to 224 inches. They're not. I go 448, then I go 312, 192, not super close. I'm going to end up chopping and adding to everybody. So now I'm gonna do another mental try. I'm trying to find what's gonna be better. So now I'm gonna take 448 and I'm gonna divide it by 3. That gives me 149. So 103 pieces of 149 will make my bottom one. My next one needs to be 312. Let's take 149, we could say 150, times 2, 312. That gives us 298. That's really close to 312. So I'm happy about that. Then, I already forgot what my number was. 149. My next one is 192. That's also kind of close to 149. My next one is 110. Oh, I can just chop off a little bit from my 149. My last one is only 80. I'm gonna just measure off a new piece to cut my 80 inches. Did that make sense? Or do I need to explain that better? So like my bottom one has a couple seams in it. Then my next one has a seam in it because it just worked out with the math. Then my next one up, I was short, so I whacked off another piece to get that. Then my next two were good to go. Actually, this one's a little long. I'm going to chop off a little bit. So by dividing our biggest one into 3, I don't have to measure off so many yards from my roll. Because if I was measuring off 448 inches, just to get the bottom one with no seam, I need 12 and a half yards of fabric. Everybody's good with that? You're good with that? You see what I did there? Some have seams, some don't have seams. We're not wasting a ton of fabric. We have a little 80-inch piece left over that we can cut some ruffles out for something else. Okay, I'm gonna move on. So I just figure out what the quickest way is. What length can I add or subtract a tiny bit to come up with all my ruffles? Because it's far faster. And, you know, when I've worked in big shops, I've driven people nuts because I'm always looking at the like, yeah, that's great that you saved a half a yard of fabric, but you worked on this for 4 solid hours. I'm much more of like, you know, by it, you save money because you have to think of what is it as hours as units. Think of hours of time as a unit of value for your life. And if you can save some time by buying an extra yard or two of fabric, you have time to actually decorate the skirt instead of, you know, sending it to the theater wishing you'd finished it. Let's make a basque. Okay. Now my white ruffle, I'm just gonna cut a whole bunch and ruffle it on our ruffler. So these ruffles, I will be dividing into fourths so that we can evenly space it around the skirt. So horrible as it is, we're gonna either have to use our Johnson ruffler and figure out the ratio per layer, which is totally doable if you're a Johnson ruffler person, or we're just gonna put gathering stitches in it or run it through the smocking machine, which, do you know which box that is? Look over there, it's a black and gold box on that like second shelf down. Yeah, I'll show you guys this other thing too. Let's make a basque. And I need a curved ruler. No, I don't need a curved ruler. Okay. So making a basque, we only need to draft half of her body. Yeah, bring that over. This actually, if anybody has seen Joffrey's Don Q or ever seen pictures of it, this is how we gathered all of those skirts, because it's a little less stressful than putting in gathering stitches that break. So this is a smocking machine. And let me just rip off a little piece of fabric here. You can thread however many needles you want with this sucker. And you can put in sturdier thread if you want. And you can let it do the gathering for you. So if I was using the smocking machine to put row 7 on, I'm going to figure out how long does it need to be when it's done so that I'm not making a much larger ruffle than I need. I'm going to start with threads on my, so this, it has needles and threads hanging off of it. I would start with loops of thread that are only an inch or two bigger than the finished attachment point on that row on the skirt, so that you know how much of this you have to feed off. Another thing that some of the makers I worked with in Houston would do, they would take a skirt like this and mentally divide the skirt into a right and a left. They'd have four gores over here, four gores over there. They'd get the ruffles on them, leaving an inch or two of ruffle not sewn on their two halves, then sew up their two halves, then seam those little ruffles together separately. And like stress-wise, it's a little bit easier to deal with two halves of a skirt that are four gores with not so much ruffle than it is to deal with the giant ruffle. So there's more than one way to do this. But if you have the smocking pleater, you just roll your ruffle on a tube or on a dowel, and then you just feed this on and work your ruffle off. And it's a lot faster than the gathering stitches on a sewing machine. And it's sturdier. So instead of having a bobbin thread and a top thread, you've got two threads going through each hole, and it's much easier to pull this and tighten it up than it is to pull a gathering stitch from a machine, and it's less likely to snap. You could also zigzag over a piece of Highmark or cotton upholstery thread, which works too, but this is just another tool you can use. Thank you, Amanda Jane. The other one is the Martha Pullen. And there's people that sell the needles that will tell you the needles are interchangeable. They are not. Okay. And there's people in foreign countries that have billions of needles that sell them on sites like AliExpress and other things. They don't know what machine you have, and they don't know what needles they have. So that can be stressful. Okay. Earlier we said that her waist is going to be 26. Her height in the front is going to be 2 inches. Her height in the back is going to be 3 inches. And that her high hip is going to be 32 inches. We did our skirt with a little bit extra. We put a little bit of ease in the high hip. And we're going to put a smidge of ease in her bosque. So we're going to make a waist of 26, a high hip of 32 and a half. We're going to make the front 2 inches high, and we're going to make the back 3 inches long. Now, for those of you that have done this with me before, I'll just switch it up a little bit. And instead of starting with the height 2 inches the whole way, we're going to start with it 3 inches the whole way, and then take away up towards the front instead of adding from the front towards the back. Same thing, just flipped. No, don't flip it. Okay. So I am going to start with a rectangle. My longest, usually we start with our shortest. I am going to start with a rectangle that is 3 inches tall, and we're dealing with half of the body, so I'm going to divide 32 and a half, which is 16 and a quarter. I didn't even need the calculator. And I like me a three-piece bosque where there's a front, a side seam, and two backs. So I need to add in seam allowance right now. So 16 and a quarter gives me a one-piece bosque. If I add an inch, if I make that 17 and a quarter, that gives me half-inch side seams. So we're going to start with a rectangle that's 3 inches by 17 and a quarter inches. And don't go all the way to the left or right or top or bottom of your paper. You want to be able to work around this rectangle. And this bosque like isn't tall enough for like a flat classical tutu here. We're just getting the top ruffle not exploding out of her waistline. So right, ruffle exploding out of the waistline is also good, but it has a less sophisticated feel. So that might be more of like a character role, not a leading lady. Okay, so now we're going to divide our high hip, which is 32 and a half. We divided that in half as 16 and a quarter. We added an inch for our seam allowance, but now we're gonna take this 16 and a quarter, half of the high hip, and divide that in half, which I already know it's 8 1/8. Okay, so from the front, I'm gonna go over 8 1/8, 8 1/8, but I'm gonna go over an additional quarter of an inch because it's more attractive for that seam line to be slightly to the back of her side instead of right at the side, okay? So I'm gonna do 8 1/8 plus a quarter. That's 8 3/8. Now, if I did my math right, I'm gonna put an inch beyond that. And in the center of that is our cut line or our side seam. So we now have a side seam with seam allowance on each side. And this side should be the back should be our 8 1/8 minus a quarter, and it's 7 7/8, so right on. So collectively, when we add these two sections together, they make 1/2 of the high hip. Our back will be on the left, and our front will be on the right. Now the next thing to do is to figure out how much we have to reduce the waist, because right now this fits the hip, the high hip, but it's too big for the waist. So I'm gonna take the difference from between my hip and my waist. So I'm gonna take 32 1/2 minus 26, and that gives me 6 1/2 inches difference, but we're dealing with half the body. So I'm gonna divide 6 1/2 into 2, which gives me 3 1/4. So 3 1/4 inches is collectively what we have to take out of the waist, out of the top edge of this sucker. And we're gonna take it out in 5 places. So I'm gonna take 3 1/4, and I'm gonna divide that by 5, gives me 0.65, ugh. Don't fear, like that's like 5/8 of an inch, right? The thing is, you can use an architect's ruler, not an engineer's ruler. So let me see. Is it the architect's ruler? No. It is, you can use an engineer's ruler, not an architect's ruler. Okay, it's good I've got both. An architect's ruler is not what you need at this moment in life. An engineer's ruler, right, 0.65. What's that? Why didn't we go metric? An engineer's ruler has a row of measurements divided into tenths. So you can count 6 1/2 tenths is 0.65. How great is that? Okay, now we're going to divide the back of this into 1/4. So we have 3 lines to divide. So we're reducing the waist. We're gonna divide the front into 1/3. So I'm gonna just eyeball the front into 1/3. So we've divided the front into 1, 2, 3 sections, which gives us 2 lines that we're gonna put a dart on. I'll hold this up to the camera before we're all done. In the back, we're gonna divide it into 1/4. So I'm gonna eyeball it into 1/2, and then I'm gonna eyeball each of those halves into 1/2. And that gives us 3 lines to reduce the waist by. So remember, we took our difference on half of our waist to high hip is 3 1/4. We divided that by 5, gives us 0.65. That's why we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 places to put a dart. Why more darts in the back, you ask? Because most people, their backside is rounder than their front side, even on a ballerina. So by having 3 darts in the back and only 2 darts in the front, and these aren't really darts, we're not sewing darts into the garment, we're using them to shape our pattern. By having more in the back, we naturally give more room for their butt to curve out over their body. So each of these spots, now I'm gonna divide by 6/10. So that's like, it's 0.65 if we want to be really ultra on top of this. So So I'm going to center kind of 0.65 tenths over each of these lines. And it would be more precise if I were using a pencil, but I am using a Sharpie. So now that we've got our, so there's our construction lines, 1, 2, 3 in the back, 2 in the front. We divided the front in thirds, and we divided the back in fourths. When we did our high hip in half, I added an inch because I want seam allowance in there and I don't want to tape it on later because I'm lazy. And then we used an engineer's ruler, not an architect's ruler, to mark 0.65 tenths. Okay. Now we're going to connect our tenths down. Actually, before I connect my tenths down, I want to do our thing where we make the front only 2 inches. So I'm going to go across the front, and I'm going to make the front only 2 inches. So we're adjusting the bosque height. And then I'm going to let it start to angle down a little bit before the side. Like on a tutu, we do the angle all at the back. But we want this skirt to slowly angle down and be its longest over her butt. You could use a curved ruler for this. Okay, so now I'm going to connect those darts all the way down to that line. You could connect them all the way to the bottom and it will still fit. By having the front darts be a little bit shorter, it's just given a smidge of room for like our seam allowance in there, our petticoat that's going to get sewn in there. But connecting the dart all the way down will also work. It's such a minor difference. And still expect to have a fitting. Now let's put seam allowance on this. I'm going to put a half an inch at the top. My front is going to be on the fold. Then I am going to put, I like to do a little more than a half an inch at the bottom of this because it gives you a little room to work with. I like to do 3/4. You could do a total inch, but I sometimes think that a whole inch is like just a little bit much, but a half an inch is like a little bit not enough. So 3/4. We're going to put 2 inches at the center back. And we're going to cut this in coutil, and I'll find something pink to stick on it. Now we are going to cut this out. Some of the makers in the Asian countries use the darts in their basques on traditional flat tutus, romantic tutus, all kinds of stuff, because their idea is that you keep the straight of grain sturdy the whole way across, and then you shape it to their body with the darts, and that's also a way to do it. But what we're ending up here is our front, I have to release the bottom, our front will be straight up and down. So their front will be nice and sturdy, and our center back will be nice and sturdy. And then having the little bit of angle or the little bit of bias over her hip at the sides will help this kind of flex to her body a little bit. So that's why I don't do the one piece basque very often. I do that for in a hurry, or for, you know, rehearsal things for a school that are going to get trashed. But if I want something to last, I like to have the side seam. And that's also nice because, like, the ideal way to fit this would be to make the skirt, kind of base the top of it on the bosque, the top of your skirt to the bottom of your bosque, stick it on her in a fitting, mark the center back row of hooks and bars, close the center back, and then do any minor adjustments at this seam at the side if you can. So now we have our center back. We have 2 inches of seam allowance. We have our sides. And then our green line in the back is with the center back. It's not. I'm in like tutu groups and sewing groups and men who sew groups and stuff. A lot of pattern makers that haven't had the opportunity to try stuff out and fail like to just fold everything in half and say, that's the grain line. But grain line has something to do with like the architectural aspects of sewing. So that's why that's our grain lines. Front on the fold, back is on the grain line. Then the bias is here at the hip to let it bend over a hip. And we still have a little bit of time. Does anybody have any questions? Yeah, we got through a lot. The only thing I was going to do remaining today, but I don't think we need to, I can just show you tomorrow, is I was going to serge the top and bottom of a couple pieces and put some lace on. But I will just show you tomorrow at the beginning what I'm doing, what I serged, where I put the lace. We could cut out the petticoat, but unless somebody's like, I need to watch Travis cut just like he cut the pink, I think we'll say that that's where we'll stop for today. Or if anybody has any questions about the bosque we just did. It's because I cheated and cut my ruffles out yesterday. No question?
Show them the head.
Oh, yeah. Should I drag her over here? Or can you point it over there? Jared's going to show you the giant mother ginger we're working on. It's huge. I'll go put. She has a hat too, but the hat's not on her. There's the first head, which is too big. But the real head is way over there. Does it show? It's black. It's hard to see. So we're headed to the suburbs tonight to put a gigantic mother ginger together. And her face is coming in the mail tomorrow. But her eyeballs and lips are too big because I screwed up the size. Ugh. When you play in Photoshop, if you go from one resolution to another, you have to remeasure things to make sure you didn't jack something up. Questions are coming in. Here we go. I should have done my hair.
Do you hem all bits then sew or sew?
Oh, somebody asked if I hem the separate gores and then sew them together. I sew them all together and then hem them. And I'll show you that tomorrow too, how I'm going to hem it. So you can hem it with a piece of horsehair braid, which makes a nice full kind of ballroom looking hem. Every column of fullness stays a nice column of fullness. And you can also cut this stuff on the bias and just stretch a tiny little piece of bias as you sew around the hem and let that fold it up, which I do because it looks nice. Actually, I'm going to go grab a can-can skirt while Jared asks the next question, because it's a good thing to look at. This ties into what we were doing. If I don't fall off the ladder and die.
Would you put horsehair in for a Catrice skirt?
Yeah, absolutely, if you want to.
I can read it here in a second.
Oh my God, come on. Oh, this is really so much. Could they hear you, or do I need to say that out loud? Someone said, should I put horsehair in a Catrice skirt? Yes or no. It is up to you. If you put the horsehair in, you'll have a bouncier hem, and she is kind of playful. So when in doubt, make up a gore or baste in a chunk of it and see if you like it. And the horsehair stuff comes in all different widths, and it comes in all different thicknesses. Like, I had gotten a ton of it in Manila that I just loved, and I'm running out of it. So now it's like, now I feel like it's all too stiff. So it comes in different thicknesses, I guess. Let's look at this, because actually this ties in to what we've been doing. I should have started with this. If I can get it out of here. We don't need the bodice. But this is a can-can skirt made like a real can-can skirt. When we did Little Dancer at the Kennedy Center, I was lucky enough to get to go into a couple museums and do the thing where you hold things with gloves and look at real clothes from history. And that's actually where this skirt resulted from. Let's count. This has 16 gores, so we're looking at 8 gores cut from a circle, like we started with, right? We started with 8 gores. This girl has 16 gores, so if you take an eighth and fold it in half, you have a 16th. Is anybody watching the Great Light Fight on television? A woman last night kept saying 2/10, and it was like so annoying because everybody around her knew she meant 1/5. She's like, we did 2/10. Anyway. This is how exciting my life is right now. So this is 16 gores across this sucker. Now check this out. One side, you can't really see it in a video, but one side of all of these is on the straight. This is the straight of grain. This is bias. This is the straight of grain. This is bias, and so on. So they're all holding each other up. So nowhere around the whole skirt is there the opportunity for anything to grow. And since this is fun, let me show you this other cool thing. Right, we've got a skirt gore here. Let's pretend that this is this skirt gore. What's cool is each of these gores, I don't know how well it shows, each of these gores has a flounce on the bottom of it. So this, the bottom section of this gore has a piece that is fuller than just the gore, which makes, see, you can kind of see it. The hem of this is fuller than a full circle. And how that is done is I just laid the gore down and I marked which side is my straight. So my straight of grain is always on this side. Then I marked this swoop on here. This is my swoop or my flounce. Gave it a couple notches. And if you've done patterning with me, you already know where I'm headed. That is a slash and spread. So I just took my swoop and I cut it. And I fanned it out like that so that I can have a flounce on the bottom of each gore. Then you obviously trace a new piece of paper to do that. And on my swoop, I also kept the grain line on the side so that this whole way down, there isn't an opportunity for anything to stretch. So this is 16 gores that are all sewn straight to bias. And then I used double face crepe. So what's cool is that my two colors of skirt came from one piece of fabric. So a lot of fun if you get like think designerly and construction-y at the same time is this fun pattern basically came up with it that I could do that with this fabric, right? Okay, so now let's investigate some more. When I was talking about bias earlier, right, look how nice, see, here's the bottom of the flounce, and it is a whack-a-chewy, curvy thing, right? But you'll see that there isn't an ugly stitch like where it's surged and folded up or something. What I've done here is this piece of black is got a little bit of stretch to it. It's like bias. It's just a piece of black mesh. And I laid the black mesh on the right side, but I pulled the black mesh a teeny bit when I sewed it so that when it laid over to the inside, it lays down flat. And then I used a blind stitch. That's what this like little Morris Cody looking purple stitch is. That's a blind stitch, which so we've rolled the edge over and up and blind stitch it down. Then you don't have a disgusting hem to look at on the outside. You just have this really pretty nice finish as if you just cut it and somehow it didn't unravel. Then let's look at the next thing. So the other thing I was talking about that you can do on this skirt, on our ruffled skirt that we're doing now, is you can put swing tacks to join the lining to the fashion. So often we think of swing tacks as the like thing that you crocheted with a needle and thread between your fingers, or like a crochet belt loop. It just means a point that connects two points. So this little bit of twill tape is also a swing tack, so that when she lifts up her overskirt, the underskirt doesn't hang completely at the waist. And you can also see that I took a piece of ribbon, this black, this is this meshy stuff. I sewed a piece of ribbon around the lining where I was putting the swing tacks. In some old books, they call this a pickup, which means my overskirt is going to pick up my underskirt, or my coat is going to pick up my lining. So where these pickups or swing tacks are, I sewed another ribbon, because otherwise, if she's going totally nuts, we needed to reinforce it a little bit so that she doesn't just rip the lining from the overskirt. So it's all reinforced. And where they're sewn on the overskirt, they're all sewn at intersections where two or three pieces of fabric intersect each other, because it's sturdier. I wouldn't want to sew it just on either chunk of fabric or just to one seam. I've got it where there's a seam intersection. Then let's look at how the bottom of the ruffled skirt. The bottom of the ruffled inside skirt is just finished with a piece of ribbon that has sequins on it, but this is a circle, right? So to get these to hang nice, see how they're not curling up like that? I eased the top edge with an awl. I pushed more ribbon top onto the bottom of my lining so that the hemmost side of my sequin ribbon doesn't curl up. So that's called satisfying the circumference. If we just sewed this ribbon straight onto here without easing a little bit, the bottom of it isn't the right size and space and will curl. Okay, now let's look at the inside. What is it? Oh my gosh, when you flip it over, it's a tiered ruffled skirt. The inside of the can-can skirt is just the outside of what we're actually doing in class. Now, let's just look at it first. And what do you see? They are longer, and then they get a little bit shorter. I think this shortens like two times. It's not evenly short, but the bottom two, and then the next two get a little bit shorter, and then we get a little bit shorter, and then our shortest one is here at the top. And that just adds a little bit of interest, in my opinion. Then all of these, you can see each one is hiding the next. And I think this is even more than an inch and a half. These guys are hidden by a little more than 2 inches. So each one of these is overlapping the next, the exact same. There you go. And, you know, just because there's sequin trim on it. Because who doesn't want an extra bit of sequins? And the top is on a bosque, just like we're doing. So, and then it's got a great big elastic on it because it buttons into the bodice. And then, like, you know, I was talking earlier about books. The waist, like the hip and waist section on this, is out of an Erte book. He was a 20s, you know, roaring 20s and a little earlier teens too designer that drew a lot of stuff that didn't get made, but a lot of it did get made. And these are like these odd angular tie shapes that like button in the same point the whole way around, and it just makes a really fun kind of baskety skirt decoration. So you can get a lot of ideas just from looking in books and trying to recreate stuff. Cool. Well, that takes us about to the end. Any last questions?
Could you use netting instead of horsehair braid?
Somebody said, could you use netting instead of horsehair braid to finish off the bottom? You totally could. The thing is, the netting won't curve with the bottom of the gore as nice as the horsehair braid does. So if I felt like I wanted to put netting on my gores to beef them up, I might cut a shaped piece of netting. I would cut a shaped piece of netting and apply it to the bottom of the gore to give the bottom some body rather than trying to apply a strip of netting. And that's it. Is that it? We'll see everybody. Going once. Got to type real fast. Going twice.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Wait, should I show everybody the puppy? Do you guys want to see the puppy?
Yeah. She's probably going to pee. Come here. Let's go outside. Come here. Come here. Come here. Come here. Oh, my gosh. So many stretches. Come on. Hurry up. Oh. Oh, come on. Come here, come here, come here. Oh, good, she didn't pee.
Look at the puppy. This is Taylor. We got her while we were on vacation. Don't walk dogs for animal shelters when you go to other countries because you'll end up with a dog. But she's great. She's learning how to go to the bathroom outside, and she's real snuggly, and she's like almost as tall as me. Look at that. And she's only 13 weeks old. She's so cute. And we're taking her to the suburbs tonight because I can't leave her at home. Okay. Thanks, guys. Bye. Say bye-bye. Say bye-bye.